Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Buddtown United Methodist Church on this first Sunday of summer. And it is hot. It is so hot, my grandma used to tell us kids that her chickens were laying hard-boiled eggs. And then she would give us a hard-boiled egg so we could see for ourselves. But I hope everybody's keeping cool and you're checking on your friends and neighbors and family and pets to make sure everybody's cool. So calendar dates are on the back of your bulletin. And I just wanted to remind everybody that next Sunday is the last Sunday to be bringing in diapers for the diaper drive. They're looking for large children sizes. And also looking ahead for July mission, we're going to be starting to collect school supplies for Southampton schools, the gift cards, and also school supplies for Pemberton. And one other thing to point out today, right after the service, is the PPR committee meeting for those who are staying. Okay. I see that Bill and Louise will be celebrating their wedding anniversary this week. How many years, Bill? 19 years. Well, I hope Louise is watching this morning while we sing to you both. May God bless you both with many, many more. And then also we have a birthday to celebrate. Nellie, she'll be watching this morning. She'll be 29. So let's sing to Nellie. Stand if you wish and join me in the gathering chorus this morning, Spirit of the Living God, page 393 in your hymnal. Call to worship. We gather to witness to the presence and power of God in this place.
We are here to recall the life of one who stilled the winds and calmed the seas.
Jesus is Lord over all creation.
And Christ is the Lord over us, on this day and always.
Please remain standing as we sing our hymn of praise this morning, God of Grace and God of Glory, page 577 in your hymnals.
Crown thy angels, churches.
You may be seated. Please join me in the opening prayer. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in the presence of your power and glory, we are overwhelmed and even afraid. Yet we are also drawn to you, for our lives yearn for the touch of your grace. May the same hand that made the storms be still bring quiet to our hearts this day. Teach us to be still and know that you are God. We confess that we have often placed ourselves at arm's length from the miracles of Galilee. We are content to read them in a book with no expectation of seeing them extended into our lives. Forgive us for being spectators of your transforming power instead of participants. Our faith is still so small. In your healing and forgiving love, draw us into an enriching faith, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our act of praise this morning is Psalm 9, verses 9 to 20, page 744 in your hymnal. 9 to 20. O Lord, our Lord. Whoops, we'll start again. Page 744. Verse 9 through 20. O Lord, our Lord, sing praises to the Lord who dwells in Zion. The Lord who avenges blood is mindful of them. Be gracious to me, O Lord. See what I suffer from those who hate me. The nations have sunk in the pit which they made. The Lord is made known. The Lord has executed judgment. The wicked shall depart to Sheol, all the nations that forget God. Arise, O Lord, let not mortals prevail.
Let the nations be judged before you.
Put them in fear, O Lord.
Let the nations know that they are mortal.
Thank you.
The epistle reading is from 2 Corinthians 6, verses 1 to 13. Paul exhorts the Corinthians to work hard for Christ because now is the acceptable time. He points out the seeming conflict between appearance and reality in regard to the Christian ministry, viewed as impostors yet true, as dying and behold we live. Hear the word of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our afflictions, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The gospel reading is from Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. The power of Jesus is revealed in the stilling of a storm. In this act, he calls the disciples to have faith. They still do not understand. Hear the word of God. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace. Be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you no faith?" And they were filled with the great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So let's give it a go. We're going to try faith of our fathers again. And, you know, he gave me faith that I should be able to do this. So can't blame it on the choir today.
Thank you. Betty for providing the extra music for us. We did notice, and I did particularly notice, that there's no choir today. So just thought I wanted to reference that so that everybody was aware of the fact that I'm familiar with that little detail. I believe I have a long wait before the choir is back in action. Who knows, a little prayer here and there might change all of that. So let's take a moment to pray together. Lord, we are so grateful for your presence with us. Thank you for these moments that we spend almost in seclusion with each other, cut off from so much that's happening around us, yet ever mindful of so much that is happening around us. But we treasure these moments when we can focus our attention on you, when we can listen to the reading of your word, when we can take time to reflect on it together. So our prayer is that as we meditate together on your word, that these reflections will be of benefit and value to us. So we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart will truly be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. In November 1942, a terrible fire swept through the crowded Coconut Grove nightclub in Boston. At the time, it was the worst and the largest fire in the nation's history. At the end, there were 493 people who died. At that time, Dr. Eric Lindemann, at that point somewhat unknown, played an active role in dealing with the survivors, but also family members of those who did not survive. Later, he wrote clinical reports on his work. And these gave rise to a whole new area of psychology known as crisis intervention. Now, that's become a catchphrase for our culture. Not only is it familiar, but it now falls easily from our lips, from telephone hotlines to community health centers, a flood of new psychological and emotional first aid is available to hurting people everywhere. Whether the problem is rape or suicide, alcoholism or child abuse, or a whole host of other issues or disasters, there is a crisis intervention team or unit to aid us. Our gospel today offers us a case of crisis intervention, or maybe we would like to call it divine intervention. The crisis is made up of 12 very frightened disciples in a sinking boat in the thundering storm on the Sea of Galilee. The intervention in this instance is done by Jesus, who also happens to be in the boat, but carelessly seems to be asleep at the time. And as the boat fills with water, the alarmed disciples awaken Jesus. Now notice the irony here. A bunch of these people in the boat are veteran fishermen. They are frightened by a storm. And they appeal to a carpenter sleeping through the storm in their boat to aid them? Something just strange about that. But clearly they were not coping well. The sinking feeling had overtaken them. Now the quiet command of Jesus, "Peace, be still," powerfully undercuts the raving madness of the storm. As nature's power is tamed by this gentle voice, the disciples now find themselves chided for their lack of faith. In these words, Jesus seems to be offering them and us a wonderful insight. Faith enables people to cope with a crisis. This does not mean that faith will remove the crisis. Many Christians seem to operate on that misunderstanding. Rather, Jesus wants us to know that faith will provide for us the handle that we need amid the storms of life. Faith helps us to remember, no matter what, no matter how extensively you and I are battered by the storms of life, no matter what, faith helps us to understand that there is a harbor for all who believe. Faith, as it were, helps us to hang in when it feels like we can no longer hang on. Now, one might say that faith reminds us that there is no cause that is ever lost. On the campus of University of Austin in Texas, University of Texas in Austin, there is an oil pump. It's placed there as an historical monument. The name is Santa Rita Number 1. The legislator endowed the university with relatively useless land in the sort of middle western part of Texas. Not unusual that that's the kind of land that they would endow to a university. But in the 1920s, Frank Pickerel became convinced that there was oil out there. But there was great skepticism. Dry hole after dry hole seemed to bear out the skeptic's view. As he was running out of money and looking for investors, Pickerel came to New York to a group of Catholic women. Their priest was singularly unenthusiastic. I know that preachers and priests can be like that with regard to causes that seem lost. He said that if they were going to invest their money in Texas oil, they should invoke Santa Rita, the patron saint of lost causes. Despite this, they invested. And they gave Pickerel a rose, blessed by this same priest, with instructions that he should climb to the top of the derrick and that there he should scatter these dry rose petals in this manner, christening or naming the site Santa Rita. And this became, believe it or not, the discovery well for the vast Permian Basin oil fields. Faith helps us to hang in during a crisis and to hang on to what sometimes seem like lost causes for us. I wonder how many lost causes you and I have walked away from. Think about it a moment. You know what I mean? Those things we instinctively felt didn't deserve our time or our energy. So we left them, we moved on. Maybe we believed that people cannot change, that situations were entrenched. So we walked away. And in doing so, we accepted second best, sometimes even third rate. We grew tired and impatient, working for what takes a long time coming. We give up too easily. Many lost causes have been assigned to the scrapyard for bruised and broken dreams. And like a wrecked ship, our hopes and our aspirations are crushed. That is what happens, isn't it, to people who lose faith. That's what happens to us when we lose faith. We take the easy way out. We accept the status quo. We stop believing, hoping, or dreaming that things can really be different. Jesus challenges his disciples in the boat. Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? It is as though Jesus would expect them to have more faith than they actually have. In effect, Jesus is saying to them, do you still not know who is in this boat with you? After all you have seen, after all you have heard, you still do not understand? Of course, of course, Jesus knew that his disciples believed. If they did not, they wouldn't be in the boat in the first place. Yet Jesus seems to be prodding them towards greater faith. It's almost unfair, isn't it? It is as if Jesus is expecting from them far more than they are able to offer. But there is another option for resolving this dilemma. One scholar, Tannehill, makes a very interesting observation. He says that Mark seems intent on demonstrating that the faith of the disciples would, not could, would grow. But growth can mean different things, right? At one level, growth in faith means that there can be more faith, greater faith, a kind of quantitative growth, that the faith in the final analysis will be more than it was before. At another level, though, the growth of faith can also be qualitative. Then faith would grow in the sense that they believe in more, that they believe in a greater God. See the difference between quantitative growth and qualitative growth? Tannehill makes the point that these disciples had more, yes, more still to learn about Jesus. Hence the question they ask each other as the storm subsides, as peace descends over them. Who is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? After Easter and after Pentecost, yes, they would know more about Jesus. That would clarify and deepen their own understanding of him, and therefore it would provide for them a faith in someone greater, even, than whom they had known before. But Tannehill point applies equally to us, doesn't it? It is not for us always a matter of having more faith. Sometimes, for us too, it is a matter of having faith in something more. Sometimes our God simply is too small. And this reminds us how our knowledge and our faith are interconnected, interrelated. As we today face various crises in our lives, you and I, we need to have faith. But how will our faith, how will your faith, how will my faith grow? How will you and I get to the place where we believe in something more? One way to grow our faith is to increase our knowledge of Jesus. That's what happened for the disciples. You and I, we do that by studying the scriptures in a more intentional way. Perhaps by listening more carefully to sermons, if they're any good anyway. But this will allow us in our studying to grow our picture, our image of Jesus, our understanding of who he is, our understanding of who God is, and therefore we will have faith in more. But here's another thing we mustn't forget. Simply having Jesus in the boat is not enough. So let us strive continually to ponder the question that those disciples ask. Who is this man? Let us keep asking the question so that the answer will end up giving us more to believe in. It is our spiritual quest. And as we struggle to answer that question, you will discover your faith will develop and grow. This, I believe, is how God intervenes in our lives constantly, if we are willing to allow it to happen. So may you and I hear Jesus speaking to us amid the storms of our own lives. Peace, be still. The serenity he brings will make us bold in clinging to causes that seem to be lost, and make us a little less content with the status quo. The serenity will give us courage to hold on to the causes that seem to be lost, and make us resistant to just being part of the status quo. We will reclaim the capacity to believe in and hope for and to dream about something which is new and bigger and different. This is the good news. It's the good news for all who want not simply to be in the boat, but want to persist in asking the question, who is this man? So let us go from here with that question in our hearts and minds, and never give up the quest. For I promise you, no matter where you are in your life, there's always more to learn. Jesus woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was dead calm. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now we're going to sing a hymn. Do we need instructions from you?
Okay.
It is the Navy hymn, and so appropriate given the theme that we have been working on. But wonderful words and a marvelous prayer. And if I have the appropriate book, then I can sing too. Thanks. 2191, Eternal Father, strong to save. You may be seated. You want more? Well, that was a new experiment. I'm not sure we've done that before, so now we know what else could be in store for us. I want to invite us to again be aware of the joy and privilege we have of giving to the work and ministry of this congregation, but also oftentimes we are giving to other causes, not lost ones, because we contribute to them. And so we are grateful for the generosity of this church. We've said it often. We may be small, but there is a mightiness about us in terms of our support of those beyond the walls of this congregation. So whether you are here or at home, thank you for the gifts that you provide that support us. We'll ask the ushers now, please, to receive our gifts.
Declan always has his hand in his pocket when he comes up here, at least one hand. And he didn't do that today, and I was waiting to see if he'd put that hand in his pocket. But nice to see he's got in both of his pockets now. So Declan, thank you always for being here and sharing in this book. Let us pray. Eternal God, we're so grateful for the gift you give us, the opportunities to give some of it back to you. So again this day, we pray that you would bless both gift and giver. Use us, we pray, in serving the congregation and beyond the congregation of this church. And we pray that you would use some of what we bring so that your kingdom may come on earth. We pray all of this in Christ's name.
Take a moment now to share our celebrations and our concerns. We would want to note that as Emma gathers with us here today, her heart is heavy. She lost a sister. There is some joy and blessing in the fact that her sister is released from all those things that held her captive, but there is still the loss. And so we will keep Ray and the family in prayer. And then we notice that stalwarts who occupy the space here have left it vacant for today. And so that's a big gap in this front part. may not be so much for you, but it certainly is for me. But so Bobby and Morgan are not here. And I guess we want to say that really both of them have days when they are challenged with their mobility. And sometimes it is very obvious which one of the two is more challenged. But there are some times when not both of them are challenged, so.
Ernie, not to interrupt you, but I texted Bobby to see if she was okay. She said Morgan was very, very confused this morning.
Yeah. So I think Morgan does have those moments, and we all know he struggles. I think the other part of that story is his wife has her moments of difficulty too. Mm-hmm. And it's harder to get her to acknowledge and admit that. So we want to keep them both in our prayers. Linton, I heard, had surgery to remove a blood clot from his leg. So we would want to, I have not seen him recently, but we'll see him early this week. But apparently the surgery went well, and he is making good progress. But I'll connect with him, and if there's anything urgent that needs to be reported, I will let you know. What's his name?
Paul.
Yes.
I'll pray for my neighbor, Wayne, who's still out in the color trying to figure out what's going on. He's at Deborah, and his wife is bedridden, has been for a while. She's trying to figure out what to do for herself and the family. They do need to do it.
And you said her name was Wendy? Wayne. And then we'd like to add again our friend Jack Johnson, former district superintendent of this district. Jack is struggling and is cognizant of that struggle. and so we've had an opportunity to see him a couple of times recently, and it's so hard to know just what one needs to say. So let me put it in the concrete terms that you understand. A hospital bed was delivered. And so that in itself tells its own story. It doesn't tell the whole story, but it tells a big part of that story. So let's take time to pray together. As we read the story of you in the boat in the storm, a story we've heard many different times with many different sermons on it too. So we're familiar with that story, and we know something of how you were able to quiet the storm out there. And the message is always the same. You have the capacity to quiet the storm inside of us as well. So we pray that you would teach us, Lord, in our own moments of trial and struggle, when we are wrestling, it seems, with life itself, by your Spirit at work in us, we pray that you will quiet the storms that we face. And at the same time, we pray that you will continue to work in our hearts and minds in such a way that our knowledge and understanding of you will keep growing, so that ultimately each of us will have faith in more. Today we hold before you all those who have been mentioned, Emma and her family circle, as they deal with the loss of Ray, Bobby and Morgan, as each of them have their own struggles to deal with, while at the same time giving encouragement and support to each other. We think of Linton, grateful for the surgery that has been successful. We pray for Paul, and recognize again how it only takes one person in a family circle to be in crisis to plunge the whole family into a kind of dis-ease. So we pray that you'll be for that family circle. Think of Priscilla's neighbor, Wayne, and ask that you will be there with and for them, helping them to make decisions about the next steps that need to be taken. And we pray for first responders everywhere. There are many different kinds of first responding that is vital and necessary for our protection and safety. But we think today particularly of those who are on the front lines dealing with fires that often are out of control, placing their own lives at risk in order to secure the safety of others. We just ask that you would be with them. Deal with them as each day they need to make the decision about causes, lost or not. Encourage them, inspire them, strengthen them. But among all of those things that we request for them, we ask this one thing: keep them safe and keep us grateful. We pray for Jack and his wife, Colleen. Pray that you will continue to surround them with your love and care. Be especially close to Jack, who has always been so good at standing alongside people as the clouds, the dark clouds, gather around them. As he sees those clouds gathering around him at this time, give encouragement to him, and be with his good wife, Colleen, who seeks not to express her own anxiety and fear, but we know she carries those deep in her spirit. Watch over them. Add your blessing to their lives. And then we pray for people who are hurting all over the world, sometimes because of terrible wars that are raging, sometimes because they simply can't cope with the heat wherever they live. Be with those others who wrestle with floods, and be with those who feel the need to leave their homes in search of a new life and a new future. As we commend all of these in your care, we ask that you would keep us always sensitive to the needs of others. Now add your blessing to our own lives as we bring our worship to an end this day. So inspire us that we may become the people you want us to be. pray all this in Christ's strong name. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 534, Be Still, My Soul. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the sharing of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.